You have to learn to manage your super traits. I mean, what are all therapists, healers, acupuncturists, massage therapists? We're all empaths. We're all empaths, and we feel the things in the room that no one else feels. So we take it on as a burden.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Christiane Northrup. How are you doing, Christiane?
Doing great.
How are you doing? Everything good?
Everything good. I was just in Atlanta, then in Asheville. I've been traveling all over the place and, meeting wonderful people. I call it God's internet. You know, we're meeting the right people. We had the very first UI Media Awards in Roswell, Georgia, outside of Atlanta. And Tim Ray and his group presented Del Bigtree, Brian Artis, Pam Popper.
Awesome.
With the awards for what we've been doing with media, you know, telling people things that other media outlets don't tell them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, so the first question is, how did you get started on your spiritual journey?
I was on it a long time when I first... First of all, my mother was wrongly accused of painting the Blessed Mother's toenails on the altar in 1935. And so she, long story, but she basically told the priest, if this is religion, I'm not interested. And so she left the Catholic Church at the age of 12. My father and mother, was married before going into World War II. She wanted the marriage annulled as soon as he got overseas. Then he meets my mother and marries her. But the church, the Episcopal Church, would not marry them because he had had an annulment. So they got married in the local hotel in the town where I grew up. So let's just say there was some questioning of mainstream religion in my life. Then at the age of about 12, I was babysitting and they had a book called Natives of Eternity, which was about angels. It's all about Flower Newhouse and her work at the Christ Word Ministry in California. And I was enthralled. It talked about angels and divas and all of this stuff. And then I read all of Edgar Cayce and reincarnation, all of that in my teens, and all of what's her name? This wonderful author who wrote about all of her past lives, but they were in novel form. So I was into this stuff a long time. And then I had family members sign out of the hospital against medical advice when the doctors didn't know what was going on. And we were brought up on Adele Davis and organic food and all the rest of it. So what I say to people is I was radicalized long before I got into medical school.
Before it was cool to be radicalized.
Well, yeah, that's for sure. Yeah.
Now, what made you want to write about energy vampires, which is something that we all can, I think, relate to at one point or another? These are people in our lives that kind of just suck the living hell out of us. So what made you want to talk about that? And what, in your definition, is an energy vampire?
That's just the most wonderful question. Well, I was working with people along the way, and then I began to notice a pattern where, you know, I didn't really want to be with them. I didn't want to really work with them, but then they'd make me feel guilty and all of that. And I was working with a psychiatrist who told me about what's called cluster B, and that's borderline personality, narcissistic, histrionic, all of that. And then I was also in my practice noticing the number of people who we would call adult children of alcoholics. They were like adult children of alcoholics, even if they had a parent who was mentally ill or divorced parents or whatever. And then I knew about the adverse childhood experiences study that was started at UCSD out in California and is now run by the CDC, which means nobody ever sees it anymore. But what they found out is that the number of adverse childhood experiences you had as a baseline was directly proportional to the number of prescription drugs you were given, the number of emergency room visits, and early death. And they studied a huge cohort of middle-aged, middle-class people in San Diego. And that's how they came up with the adverse childhood experiences. But I'd also been doing work in recovery. with, you know, codependence and Melanie Beatty and, you know, codependent no more and all of that. And then when I learned about cluster B in psychiatry and then learned about narcissism, which I'd never heard of, by the way, in the night, never heard of. Then I realized, holy mother, this is pervasive. I found out it's 1 in 5 people. If you are a primary care doctor, OBGYN, family doc, that's 25% of your patients at any given time. It's this, help me, you can't. And, right. you know, then I'd had lawsuits. I'd been reported to the Board of Registration in Medicine when I hadn't lived up to their expectations of being a deity. You know, help me, you're the only one who can help me. And then I'd realize they'd been to 500 other doctors who could never help them. And so I finally realized people needed to understand this personality type. I began to work with George Simon, who wrote In Sheep's Clothing, and Sandra Brown, who wrote Women Who Love Psychopaths, a book I couldn't even look at first. Mm-hmm. And then I learned that there was a subgroup of people who had super traits of loyalty, compassion, can do, that kind of thing, but they were almost constitutionally congenitally blind to the negative traits of others. So there was a belief that, and the New Age movement added gasoline to this fire in a big way. Everyone hurts others only because they were hurt in childhood. That is the answer to everything. And if you just love them more, then you could redeem them. And what I tell people is the only place that a personality disorder is redeemed is in the movies. And at the end, you know, the guy or the woman, oh, I'm so sorry for everything that I did to you and I'll make it up to you. A really good one recent was the series Made on Netflix. The beauty of Made on Netflix, it doesn't do the Hollywood ending. The mother-daughter relationship in that stays absolutely true to what it was till the very end. It's Andie MacDowell and her daughter playing these two roles. It's really, really good. It's like, oh, finally, you get it. No, the daughter redeems herself. The daughter finally heals. And so I didn't realize when I wrote that book that it was predictive programming for where we are now. I had no idea. I just knew it had to be written. And so there was a whole lot of healers, empaths born with a negative ego. We're constantly looking for things to improve about ourselves. And then we've got the narcissists born with a superior ego that nothing they do is wrong. And I realized from, you know, being out in the Hamptons, being in New York City, being in all of these, that there was this whole subgroup of people that looked so good. They're larger than life. They're beautiful. And I was realizing these are the energy vampires, because I began to notice myself. I would want to fall asleep in my soup when I was around them sometimes. One woman, she's very, very famous. I won't mention her name, but I'm having lunch with her at her mansion and I'm digging my fingernails into my palm to keep from falling asleep. I did her tarot cards. I did her astrologic chart. I did anything to keep myself from just lying down on the oriental carpet and falling asleep. That's an energy vampire, where they're literally draining you. You don't know why you feel so bad and you're blaming yourself. I should be able to handle this. I should be able to be around this person. Very often you have a parent who's one of that type, and then you marry it or you have it as your boss. And it's a pattern that we all, especially those of us who would call ourselves empaths, star seeds, whatever, we need to be aware of it. I also was involved in transcendental meditation. A lot of ashrams would find out, you know, that the chief guru was sexually, you know, having sex with everybody. I mean, it became so common that at this point, you know, if somebody is really charismatic and really good looking, it's like, they got to prove their worth or I'm not going to be around them. I did. I have a product line called Amata Life, which is a wonderful product line for menopausal women and also some stuff for men. But the guy I was working with to help me bring it to fruition, I found out later had 4 passports and probably worked for the Mossad. So a total psychopath. But like a lot of psychopaths, now, Lee Merritt told me this one. This is interesting. So Lee Merritt, Dr. Lee Merritt, orthopedic spine surgeon with the Navy, she said, the Navy is so good at determining through psychological testing who can stay under the polar ice cap in a submarine for 3 months, right? You can't have someone who's going to lose it. So then you have to surface. She said, there's one type they cannot screen for, and that's a psychopath.
Mm-hmm. Now, what's the difference between a psychopath and a sociopath?
They're about the same. About the same. Yeah, there's a continuum. I want everyone to know, because, you know, as I'm talking and you're listening, chances are names are arising in your head. It's like every family has one. They drive everyone crazy at Thanksgiving or Christmas. You can't do right by them.
It's so interesting because, you know, I feel myself that I can feel people out pretty well when I meet them, and I can sense them. And after doing hundreds of these interviews at this point in the game, I could generally pick up within the first few minutes of talking to somebody or even just seeing someone in an interview, kind of get their energy. There's been a few people that, and I work, I don't know if you know this or not, but I work in the Hollywood. So there's none of this in Hollywood.
Oh
none.
My God.
None.
I did not know that. Okay.
No. I've been in the film industry for 30 years. I've never come across any of these people that you're talking about, ever, but, I mean, you know, to have someone sit there and go, I'll see you at the Oscars next year. I'm like, okay. You never made a movie. Got it. So the insanity that I've dealt with over my lifetime is insane. But there's certain things that there's like, and there's one person that's coming to mind who will not be named.
Yep.
When I met them, this toxic energy, it was such a toxic, they did nothing to me personally. They've never said a mean word to me. They've never done anything mean to me ever or anybody around me. But I just feel disgusted being around them. And they're, again, don't have anything. It's so weird. Like, one thing is when someone says something to you, I get that. But this is just literally being in their presence. And I told the people that I was with, I'm like, I can't be around that person anymore.
Right.
Like, I can't.
Yeah. Because you can feel what, okay, here's what they're doing. They have an abyss inside. They have an abyss. There's nobody home. And they're very divorced from their soul. What they're doing is they use other people for their energy supply. So, you know, some very famous people have said, you know, my family is the front row, meaning at their concerts or their whatever, I'm most comfortable on stage. Are you kidding me? I mean, that means they are feeding off the audience and they can't really be alone. I think this is why there are so many people, and you probably know way more than I do, in Hollywood, what they say is narcissists don't age well. They don't age well.
They do not.
Yeah.
And also, they, like you were saying, that they need that energy to kind of, when the spotlight is off or the audience is not there, they turn to something else to fill the void. And it's generally drugs and alcohol or sex addiction or some other thing to fill that void. But I always tell people anytime, you know, because you can get into the woo-woo-ness of like, oh, I feel the energy of somebody. And that's fine. I understand that. I feel it and get it. But a lot of people, when I say things like that, they're just like, what are you talking about? I go, let me ask you a question. You ever been in a car lot and you were trying to get a car? Have you ever talked to a sales guy and you just feel like you need to take a shower afterwards? Or if you're a woman, have you ever been trying to be picked up by a sleazy guy at the bar? And, you know, he said maybe 3 or 4 lines to you, but afterwards you're just like, ugh, I just feel like that's something. I don't know what you call it, but that is a visceral action that we have. And whether how you ever want to define it, it is something. And I felt it. I think everyone has felt it at one point or another.
Yeah. And here's the thing. You're talked out of that often in childhood. So what we want to do instead is empower our children. And if you feel this, tell your parents or run. The problem is if one of your parents is one of these people and they're, you know, that's a problem. But, you know, then we get into soul choices. Oh. Then we get into, you know, like, okay. And that has served me well. you know, reading all of Edgar Cayce, realizing, mm-hmm. all right, we came down to schoolroom Earth, or at this point, the gangster planet that we're on. And we came here to co-create with God, to turn around this planet, because what we do on this planet affects the entire universe. You can do something on this planet to transmute negative energy. It affects the whole universe, because this is the place that's hardest. It's not hard anywhere else. It is really hard right here, right now.
Oh, and it doesn't seem to be getting any easier. I think we're still going into a darker time. I don't think we've hit bottom yet. I think we will come out of it. But we'll come out of it.
I'm convinced.
Yeah, no doubt. But I don't think we've hit bottom by any stretch. I think we're on the slow. There's just too much stuff going on. I talk about this with almost all my guests. It's like, okay, there's this shift. There's this shift going on. You could just look at it. I mean, I don't remember 15 hurricanes in May when I was growing up. Like, I don't remember the economy is going bad, the political tribalism, the pandemic that affected the entire world at the same time. All these things are like shifting us. I call it the great etch-a-sketching of the world of humanity. It's kind of like we're being shaken. and hopefully we'll come out of this in a positive way. But like so many people say, it's like chaos is the fertile ground for change. And that's where we're at right now, because there's definitely a little bit of chaos. Oh, and I forgot about World War III. We're on the brink of World War III as well. So there's that.
No, we're in the middle of it. In the middle of it. And here's the other thing, though, that it's done in a most beautiful way. It has separated the wheat from the chaff. Holy mother. Do you ever know who your friends are at this point?
I can't, like when a lot of this stuff started happening and the political stuff happened and all this kind of stuff happened, all that's been there. It didn't just show up. In the 80s, it wasn't any better or worse. I think now, because of the internet, because of social media, because of things happening in society that allow people to just say, you know what, I'm just going to say what I feel, as opposed to being the crazy uncle at Thanksgiving who would say it when he got drunk. Now he's TikToking it, or he's on Twitter and tweeting it or something along those lines. And they've built a website about it and things like that, that weren't accessible to people in the 70s and 80s. But I don't believe there's less crazy in the 60s, 70s and 80s than there are 90s than there is now. I just think that it's just exposed, it's brought everything up. And like you're saying, it's definitely opening up doors to who people really are inside. And I think sometimes some of that stuff has to be shown into the light before it can get healed in many ways.
Well, here's the way I explain it. You ever been in an apartment where there are cockroaches? Okay. You go into the kitchen at night, you turn on the light. Whoa, they're all scurrying.
Scattered.
Yeah. So what we're doing is we're exposing the cockroaches and also the vampires, because they don't like light. Isn't it weird, since you worked in Hollywood, that suddenly in the 90s, in the early 2000s, I guess more in the 2000s, we have all these vampire things. We got Twilight. We got True
Blood. It's cyclical. It kind of comes and goes.
Yeah. Yeah. But all of a sudden, that's really the truth. I mean, it's the truth. They will suck your blood.
There's no question.
Yeah.
So what are some of the health issues that arise from toxic relationships, like just being in one? Is there physiology, mental, spirit? What are these things that are happening to us by being in a toxic relationship?
Well, here's the ones that are the most common. I would always wonder why these women, because my patients have been women, why these women would do everything, organic food, acupuncture, everything, and they'd still suffer from chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia, autoimmune disease, chronic Lyme. Now, this is before the pandemic, so they'd have all that, and invariably, you would find out that their life energy was being constantly drained by living with an energy vampire. And once they got rid of the energy vampire, which is not easy, by the way, because we become addicted to them. But once you get out of there, then suddenly their immune system begins to work. So being around those people will increase your inflammatory markers, like IL-6 and all the cytokines and all the rest of it. Literally, you are being bled to death of your life energy. So you don't have it to heal. And you're always second guessing yourself. Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean. And remember that the energy vampire is a professional victim. No matter what you do, no matter how much you give to them, it's not enough. But they have malignant intuition. So they know exactly when to give you a crumb so that you will stay and keep giving them what's called narcissistic supply. So that is money, attention, sex, all caring, narcissistic supply. And when you cut that off, they're going to start to ramp it up. So when I tell people about this, it's like just what you just said, prepare for things to get a little worse before they get better, because they don't want to have that cord clamped. You've been a source for them.
Now, I have to ask you, I'd love to hear your opinion on this whole Johnny Depp, Amber Heard thing, because that seems like a fairly toxic relationship. And that all of it came out into the light in this remarkable court hearings. I'd love to hear your thoughts on both of them, how, because there's definitely an energy vampire in one of those two. And there's definitely some narcissism in both of them. One or both, I'm not sure. You know, whether I'm a fan of Johnny Depp as an actor is irrelevant to what we're having a conversation about. But it just, I don't know. I'd love to hear your thoughts on it.
What I loved about that case, and I didn't follow it, but I followed enough of it, was the psychiatrist who said about Amber Heard, this is a personality disorder. This is how it is. So she's a classic borderline. They're seductive. They're good looking. They're a succubus. And what I say to men is I wanted to have a course for men way back, but I need a course for men so that you know who these women are, because they will drain you dry and leave you as a husk on the side of the road. And that's her. And that's her. I don't know anything about him. I just know that I loved that on the world stage, we finally exposed a borderline woman and how they operate. Because here's what happens to a good man, like a good, normal man. He goes for a woman like that, seductive, beautiful, all of it. And if she doesn't smile, if she seems like, I always use the Victoria Beckham, like never smile. Oh, I'm so cool.
Posh.
I'm so posh. You know, it's like, stay away. But what happens to good men, they think they can save them. Oh, she doesn't seem very happy. I could make her happy. I really think that I could, you know,
on a subconscious level,
because what is masculinity? It's to protect and serve. And men want to please women. And I'm not going to get into the transhumanism. Yes. So that's what happens. And you get sucked in. It's the Black Widow. If you look at Alex Dibney, all of his HBO specials, like Out for Blood in Silicon Valley, Elizabeth, whatever her name is there, they're all psychopaths. They're all sociopaths. Every single person. What was that place? The Smartest Guy in the Room, about Enron.
Oh, God, that was remarkable. Yeah.
It's remarkable. This is sociopathy. Yeah. So Amber Heard, for whatever reason, and you know, it's like, okay, the whole world, it looks like all the old structures are falling apart. So why did they televise this whole thing when what's her name? Jeffrey Epstein's procurer. Mm-hmm. You know, they didn't know that you couldn't have anyone in the courtroom. They just had, you know, a few pictures of her. So even that, like, why are we doing that? Yeah.
Well, this is, I've never seen a case like this. Something like this has never been televised.
Right. Thank God that it was. And, you know, particularly, I mean, you got to love the circus of it. The guy who's driving and he's vaping and, you know,
he's waving to his fans and he's joking. And, you know, and even on the stand, you could just see that at least from my point of view, she was really overacting.
Oh yeah.
I mean, so overacting. She had an answer for everything. She never took, responsibility for anything.
That's the other thing. They never, it's always, you're doing it to them.
Right. Right.
Now another person where they're doing it to him is Fauci. I mean, right. I don't know if you, you know, but it's like, you're interrupting my dinner. I can't believe that it's always when someone is constantly running for the victim role, takes no responsibility whatsoever.
I mean, at least Johnny would say, you know what? Yeah, I was doing a lot of drugs then.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? I was doing this or that. She never said that once, never yeah. once, even with audio recordings.
Right.
Proving that she was saying what she was saying. It was pretty remarkable.
Yeah.
Now, is there a way, are there tips of how you can identify a energy vampire?
Yes. Okay. First of all, they tend to be better looking, larger than life, charismatic, and you've got to go by how you feel. Now, here is the problem. I think it's like Sandra Brown's research showed how many people have what are called super traits. And that's super traits of loyalty, compassion, can do. These are the people running the corporations. They clean up every bathroom they've ever been in at a gas station, make it better than, you know, these are the people who are the fixer uppers. And if it comes to a business or a home or whatever, they win every time. They're incredible. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to relationship, they choose the fixer-uppers. Oh, I can help him. Okay. So what you need, if you have these super traits of congenital blindness to these people, then you need to have a wing woman or man to say, hey man, it's taken me years. I'm one of them. It's taken me years. Because at first I'm so enthusiastic. Oh my God, you've got to meet this person and here's what they're doing. And, you know, and luckily I have someone who's worked with me for years and she goes, I get a really bad feeling. I get a bad fit. Mm. So at this point, I listen to her. I didn't in the past. I'd have to work it out myself. So the way I would say it is, and remember, they have malignant intuition. They tell you what you've always longed to hear. Oh man, you're so handsome. You're so strong. Or you're so beautiful. You're so sexy. And look at what you can do. And the way you help people, it just moves me to tears. They are over the top, the love bombing kind of a thing. If it seems too good to be true, it's too good to be true. They're larger than life. So they make normal people seem boring. So those of us who have the super traits and who are the empaths, we got to look at our own stuff. Like, why am I attracted to that? What is it about me that feels inadequate, that I need that kind of thing? Okay. So you need someone who's going to tell you, but if they begin with a sob story, okay, so let's say you're out at a cocktail party. Some guy comes up to you and says, oh, you know, my wife won't let me see the kids. I'm recently divorced, but she won't let me see the kids. Okay. A normal, healthy woman will go, oh my God, what a loser. What a stupid pickup line that is. An empath, an old soul empath with super traits will go, oh God, I really think I could help you. So you have to learn to manage your super traits. I mean, what are all therapists, healers, acupuncturists, massage therapists? We're all empaths. We're all empaths. And we feel the things in the room that no one else feels. So we take it on as a burden. And, you know, I said to one woman I was working with, okay, right now, here's what you need to do. You need to say to your body, your physical body, I love you and I no longer give you permission to feel and act out what other people in the room are not willing to feel. Because our bodies are barometers of the life force in the room. So we can trust ourselves. But a lot of times you will not know, suddenly you're in a room, suddenly you're feeling depressed. You kind of do a tick check. Am I depressed? And you find out you're the air purifier for everyone else. So you got to really learn to manage your super traits. And really, you know, I mean, it's like ridiculous, but you got to really learn to love yourself more.
Now, how can you remove yourself from a toxic relationship? Because one thing is like that car salesman that I talked to you about, or somebody that you're just meeting at a party. But if it's your parents, if it's your brother or sisters, if it's a friend, it's a mate, how do you start to pull away from that kind of relationship?
Okay. So first thing, let's assume maybe it's your in-laws, right? So what you do is you send cards. Cards are a really good way to do it. Just send little cards if they're, you know, if let's say they want to call you every night and you just don't answer the phone, but send a card. I'm thinking of you. They never go away. So you need to understand they find another source of narcissistic supply. So before I forget it, let me just say, in a marriage, if you finally decide that you've had it, like I said this to a friend of mine who was married to, a real handsome narcissist. I said, are you going to be able to deal with it when he has another woman in 15 minutes? Will that be okay with you? Yeah, it'll be okay with me. Guy's married to an oil heiress, right? Going all over the world. And meanwhile, when he was married to her, he had back problems, always had a medical problem, always had something. And she earned all the money. She took care of everything. And then he finally ramped it up to the next higher level. So that's when you finally decide you can't take it anymore. But for the people you cannot leave, you have boundaries like, okay, we're going over to my mother-in-law's. We're coming at 1, we're leaving at 3. And then you just, you make that solid. The other thing you do, here's the other thing they do. They will never call you till they need something. Okay. Mm-hmm. Never. They will not check in. Oh, just, I was thinking of you, how you doing? No, they only call when they want something or need something. So you need to practice. As I'm talking to you, you know who this is. You need to practice. I'll get back to you.
Right.
Your knee-jerk response is, of course I can help you. I'll cancel all my plans for this Saturday to help you move. And then if you don't cancel those plans, you're going to feel guilty. So you got to be able to deal with your guilt. So this is the phrase, I'll get back to you. Now, that's elementary school level. High school level is, I simply can't. Do not make excuses except for one excuse that works almost every time. And that is broken wing. Can you come over and help me? Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm not feeling well. They will never, ever go towards someone who has a need. They're the only ones who get to have a need. So always use the broken wing thing. Let's say it's a colleague at the office. They're always coming into your office and you want to get your work done, but they're always in there and you feel guilty. So, hey, there you do black rock, gray rock, gray rock, just a gray rock. Don't give them any attention whatsoever. Nothing. You're going to feel guilty. The first time you do it, you will feel guilty. So you got to learn how to manage, and then you get better and better and better. And then you see it coming from a mile away and you don't get sucked in anymore. You can, if you were to do a timeline, like in my own life, so I've got this, and then I was married to it for 24 years. And then I have a best friend, 12 years, business colleague, 3 years. Now I see it coming.
So you said something earlier about self-love or self-worth. How do we build more self-worth and more self-love? Because this is, when you get to a certain point in your life and you're very comfortable in your own skin and you know who you are, these kind of things, you can spot them pretty easily and kind of avoid those scenarios, but it takes time to get to this place. Not everybody is born with self-love and self-worth. So how can you build that inside of you?
You actually, one of the easiest ways, believe it or not, is the Louise Hay classic, mirror work.
Oh, yeah.
Where you look into a mirror. You do this for 30 days. You look into the mirror and into your eyes and you say, I love you. I really love you. I used to practice when I go to meetings of the American Holistic Medical Association. We always had them in Seattle. And I would do this whole thing when Mount Rainier, you could see Mount Rainier. And I believe in, you know, the spirit of a mountain, especially that majesty of that mountain. And I would have that mountain out my hotel window. I'd have the mountain just report back to me, my magnificence. And, you know, you do it in the privacy of your own room, because if you were to tell people this, they think, you know, what an idiot. At this point, I'll tell anyone that stuff. I don't care. But at the time, that was a real growing edge place. But the mirror work is life changing, life changing.
I feel that if you're a little bit more spiritually enlightened and more connected to your true self, as you said earlier, they're really departed or disconnected from their soul.
Yeah.
The more disconnected from the soul, the more you are grounded in this kind of reality, as far as the physical reality is concerned. That's where you could do certain things that you wouldn't if you're more connected to who you truly are. Is there ways that any techniques that you've learned over the years that can help us connect to our higher self a little bit more, to connect to our true self? Because the closer we are to that, or to source or the universe, whatever that is. So, because that does give you strength, and it does give you a foundation that is you're not easily pulled off of.
Right. So what you need to understand, okay, we all know this, is that we are vibrating at a certain frequency, and that is our point of attraction. So Napoleon Hill said in 1925 in his book, Think and Grow Rich, thoughts have the peculiar quality of becoming their physical equivalents. All right. So then, you know, we get into all the work of Esther Hicks, Abraham Hicks, all of that, choose the thought that feels better. There's a lot to be said for that, where you're practicing in your mind that you're going to change your thought patterns and then see what happens. I just talked with a guy, this was really interesting, and he liked alcohol, martinis and wine and all that, but it was making him stupid at times. So he kind of pre-paved the way for himself, and he began to have little scenarios in his head, what his life was going to be like after alcohol and how this would blossom for him and this business. And he would be so clear. And then he had a moment with his wife where he's got his friend visiting, and he's had one too many, and he's, you know, kind of like this. And she looks at him and says, "You are so brilliant. You cannot do this anymore. Look at what's happening here. Your brilliance isn't able to shine through at all because you put the spirit in the wrong container." And he had pre-paved it so much that that was it. Never drank again. Never. Doesn't even want it. He had pre-paved it. You've got to have a connection with the greater part of us that isn't even in a physical body. That's the way I like to see it. It's like you got a part, an all-knowing part that is totally connected with God. And I believe God comes through us as us. Mm-hmm. And you got this part that's bigger, that sees this broader perspective. And your job, because you're here to transform matter. This is the densest thing in the universe. You're going to transform it. You're going to raise the vibration. You got to start with yourself. So you have to practice. I did years of, I would take Catherine Ponder affirmations from her book, The Dynamic Laws of Prosperity, or The Dynamic Laws of Healing, or whatever. One of my favorites when I was going through a divorce and thought I would lose the house, is I had to really get it about prosperity. And she talked about this stuff called divine radiant substance. Tesla called it the ether. And it's not nothing. It's everything. And so the affirmation was, divine radiant substance cannot be withheld from me, and it can't be taken from me. I now manifest divine radiant substance in wonderful, prosperous ways for myself. So I began to see myself as manipulating the very stuff of creation with my thoughts. And my whole life turned around. I also, you know, God moves mountains, bring a shovel. So I did, you know, I read all of Robert Kiyosaki, the cash flow quadrant, saw myself as a business, you know, all of that stuff. You've got to do the practical stuff, but the practical stuff will not work unless you've changed your point of attraction. I mean, I remember being afraid to go into my broker's office because I felt like kind of, oh, you know, I was unsophisticated and there he is with his cufflinks and his perfect shirt and the desk without a thing on it, you know, and I found those institutions of money very, very scary. And I realized, yeah, they do that on purpose. So you don't feel worthy. And now, you know, now I'm like, yeah, well, you work for me. So, and my field is gynecology. So that's second chakra. That's money, sex, and power. That's where we wear our wallets. It's where we wear our knives. It's where we wear our guns. It's the weaponry of going after what you want. Now, the only key to living a wonderful life is you got to move it up to your heart. You got to combine those two things. But you got to really get it together in the second chakra with money, sex, and power. And that affects the health of the reproductive system. That affects the health of the ovaries. It affects the health of the testicles. And right now, by the way, testosterone levels have gone from like 650, like in the 50s, 60s, they're 250 now. And sperm counts have gone down for 60 years. By the year 2035, they'll be zero if we continue to do what we're doing, which we are not going to do. Mm-hmm. But this is where you begin to take care of your body in a way that you know that this body responds to your thoughts and that through physical exercise and so on, you can become something that you couldn't do before. It's very, very empowering, you know, sound mind, sound body. I've had women go through menopause, getting totally empowered just through weightlifting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No, yeah, no question. Now with all of this, we understand now how to identify, why we do it. How can we build healthy relationships? How can we identify healthy relationships so we can build those and build a group of people around us that will support and help us move forward in life as opposed to suck the energy or become succubuses or hang on you as baggage or so on?
I would have the intention to find like-minded people. Like this past 2 years, I have found more soul tribe members than in my entire life. And that's one of the beauties of this time frame, is to realize that you never need to pretend to be anyone but yourself, because who you really are, with the right people, you can say all of who you are. You know, one of the things I'm doing right now is launching a dating site for people who haven't had the experimental biologic injected into them, because those of us who have little grandchildren or little children realize we're going to need summer camps, theater camps, restaurants, hotels. We're going to need places that value our native humanity, our native DNA. So I think it starts with the intention, but also if you're a guy, let's say, and you're looking to date someone, don't ever go for the woman who's not smiling. Don't ever think I can save her. Then what you want to do, you got to go for the one who appreciates you, who says, thank you. The women's movement, as important as it was, really wrecked male-female relationships in a lot of ways. I use the slogan from the 70s, a woman needs a man like a fish needs a bicycle. What? Okay, so what we want, the family, mother, father, children, is the absolute subunit of a healthy society. We know that in World War II, the men who survived in the prisoner of war camps were the ones who had happy childhoods. The ones who came from the inner city who were in gangs and didn't have parents, those were the first to die, because hope and education and understanding that things can get better because of your thoughts and so on, that that nails in survival into the immune system. So I would always pay attention to, how do I feel around this person? Like, do I feel better? Or is the person kind of criticizing me? I'll give you an example. I was just with a woman and she went out to dinner with an old boyfriend. And he said to her, and she's now happily married, he said to her, well, you know, you were one of the most beautiful women I ever met. And he was wanting, he was really putting her down. And mm-hmm. she said, let me tell you something. I have never been happier with who I am because I have developed my insides. And back then when I knew you, I was using drugs. I was using relationships. I was doing everything. Yeah, I look good on the outside. I was a mess. I like who I am now. Yeah. So again, it's the mirror work. As you like yourself, your point of attraction changes. The kind of people who you attract are completely different. But if you're always got your nose pressed up against the glass, like, you know, I used to go down out in the Hamptons, I had a friend out there, and, you know, your nose is always pressed up against the glass of these, the beautiful people, and what are they doing? And, oh, you know, I don't have to tell you, you've been in the Hollywood scene. Yeah. So I like to be around, you know, the real folks that we have in our group, Maine Stands Up. We've got a lot of former special forces medics. We got farmers. We got people who are just doing things with their hands, you know, plumbers, electricians, carpenters, people who are doing stuff and contributing to society in that way.
Now, Christiane, where can people find out more about you, your books, and the work you're doing?
DrNorthrup.com has pretty much everything. I've got a big Telegram channel. I'm about to start a Substack because I'm getting tired of the bots on Telegram. I'd like to be able to do a live on Instagram, but I've lost three channels. I'm trying to change the algorithm now on my current one. I'm on Twitter. I've got a newsletter. You know, my e-news is where you're going to find, you know, and that's free. So you go to drnorthrup.com, sign up there. I've got a YouTube channel, you know, with a lot of medical stuff on it. Yeah. But the you know, the gangster stuff is on Telegram.
Dr. Northrup, thank you so much for being on the show. I truly appreciate it. And thank you. Thank you again for everything you do. I appreciate it.
Okay.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.